am talking on a topic today that is very near and dear to my heart and my womb. I'm giving this lecture because I believe there's a very important connection between insulin resistance and sexual health, and I'd like to show you the data behind this. Simply put, you need to watch what you eat if you want to get it in the sheets. And I think it is a basic human right for everyone to have a satisfying sexual life, and it is our duty as physicians to help foster this with our patients. So, over the next 45 minutes, I plan on first reviewing the statistical data on how prevalent sexual dysfunction is in both genders. Then we're going to spend a bit of time exploring the correlation between metabolic syndrome and sexual dysfunction in both genders. I'll spend a bit of time exploring the connection with insulin resistance and infertility in both men and women. And I hope by the end of this talk, people will understand that any person presenting with any signs of sexual dysfunction should consider screening for insulin resistance. A little bit about myself. Yes, I'm in private practice. I also am chief medical officer at PlateJoy and medical director at Miro Health. Now, when I say sexual dysfunction, what exactly do I mean? So sexual dysfunction, by definition, is any disturbance in sexual desire and in the psycho-physiologic changes associated in the sexual response cycle in men and women. And the sexual response cycle, it's a series of four physiologic phases that occur in both men and women during intercourse. So sex first begins with arousal, and then there's an excitement phase followed by plateau. Sex peaks in orgasm and then falls with resolution. And some people who are carb addicted say they experience the same cycle as well. But that's a different talk, obviously. So I want to emphasize that sexual dysfunction, it's actually a multifactorial, multidimensional disorder. And I'm only going to talk about one aspect of sexual dysfunction. There's actually many causes. A lot of the medications that are commonly prescribed, like antidepressants or beta blockers, they can impair sexual function. Any kind of stress to the body, like a recent illness or surgery, can lead to sexual dysfunction. Psychological trauma plays a huge role in someone's ability to perform. Hormonal changes, like naturally occurring changes such as menopause, or the use of exogenous hormones like oral contraceptives. Now, I'm not an OBGYN, I'm not a psychiatrist, I'm not a sex health expert, I'm just an internist, so I'm going to be focusing on the vascular dysfunction and how it can affect sexual health. And before I get into the data, I think it's really important to understand that there's actually major issues when it comes to sexuality studies. Most of the studies are done on heterosexual couples, white couples who come from middle to upper socioeconomic classes. Most of the studies strongly are skewed. They focus on men and male sexual dysfunction. The studies in women are lagging far behind. And I don't know if it has to do with societal taboos when it comes to female sexuality, or the fact that there's not as much standard definition of what female sexual dysfunction is, or the fact that there's not very well validated instruments. But the point being that this data that I'm about to present, it needs to be treated with a lot of caution. There's a very few rigorous RCTs. Most of the data is observational. So let's just take it all with a grain of salt. Now, when it comes to how prevalent sexual dysfunction is, it's quite prevalent. It's very common. It's more common in women worldwide. 40 to 50% of women have sexual dysfunction, irrespective of age. And for men, the numbers are lower, but age plays a greater role. And for men, the most common complaint is erectile dysfunction. So men are upset because they can't perform. For women, the most common complaint is low sexual desire. So women are upset not because they can't perform, but they just don't want to. And married people had a lower risk for experiencing sexual symptoms compared to their non-married counterparts. And when I found this out, I was wondering, is it because married couples are partnered and therefore they're more likely to work on the issues? Or is it that married couples are partnered and they're just so unhappy that they've given up on complaining even? And so, I don't know. There needs to be more data behind that. But let's begin where there is a lot of data. Erectile dysfunction. Can't get it up, can't keep it up. So as you saw by the commercial I played, the pharmaceutical male sexual enhancement industry is a multi-million dollar industry, and it's continuing to do quite well. Men are sold this idea that you can just take a pill and you can improve the odds of having an erection. But I'm here to tell you, yes, the odds are good, but the goods are still odd, because erectile dysfunction is a sign of cardiovascular disease. So this was data gathered from a National Health and Nutritional Examination survey. They surveyed about 20,000 men, and they asked these men, do you never have an erection, or do you only sometimes get an erection? And about 4,000 men responded, yes, that's the case for me. So they did have erectile dysfunction. They then went ahead and did a logistic regression analysis to look at how many of those men had either undiagnosed diabetes, undiagnosed high blood pressure, or undiagnosed hypercholesterolemia. And what they found was that there were definitely a higher percentage of men with erectile dysfunction who had undiagnosed hypertension compared to men without ED, but after adjusting for confounders, that data wasn't statistically significant. For cholesterol, there was no statistical correlation between having ED and having high cholesterol. But with diabetes, erectile dysfunction was strongly associated with undiagnosed diabetes in both the adjusted and unadjusted analyses. And that relationship was strongest for men in the age group of 40 to 59. They found that the predicted probability of having undiagnosed diabetes in someone without erectile dysfunction went from 1 in 50 to 1 in 10. Then the connection between the impact of diabetes on erectile dysfunction is actually well explored in the literature. But I found this incredible NIH-funded study that what I would call a truly intimate dive into the effects of diabetes on sexual function. So they took 40 men with diabetes, and then they age-matched them with 40 healthy volunteers. And none of these men had any concurrent illnesses. They were not obese. These men were not on any other meds. The only meds prescribed were diabetes meds. They were under the age of 65, and they were all either married or in a stable relationship with a female partner for more than a year, and there was no substance abuse, no alcoholism, no one was complaining of whiskey phallus or anything like that. And so they then interviewed these men and their partners on psychosexual variables between the diabetic men and the healthy men. And they even they looked at the validity of these differences by even asking the assessment of the sexual partners. This was your standard sexual questionnaire asking about things like desire, arousal, sexual satisfaction. This was no big deal. You know, if you love questionnaires, sexual research is the branch for you. And they showed that diabetic men had significant decreases in sexual desire, subjective arousal, erections across the board, whether it was in coitus, masturbation, or in sleep, and decreased frequency of sexual satisfaction. They also found that there were a higher proportion of diabetic men who had problems with a lack of sexual desire and erectile impotence, as well as premature ejaculation. I mean, this is a self-reported questionnaire. This is not high-quality data. We already know this. You know, the more cookies you eat, the less cookie you'll get. You can't have your cookie and eat it too. So what was fascinating about this study was that they then went on to take these men and they subjected them to a sleep lab for 3 nights, where they then proceeded to do a polygraphic sleep assessment and then a nocturnal penile tumescence monitor continuously throughout the night. This is incredible that the NIH funded this. And what was fascinating, this is a direct quote from the study. So the first 2 nights, the men were left undisturbed. Then during the 3rd night, visual checks were carried out during tumescent episodes to ascertain degree of erection in relation to the recorded increase in penile circumference. Then the subject and observer separately rated the degree of erection on a 1 to 10 scale, which I would call the he's not that into you scale, where 1 was no erection at all, 5 was a partial but adequate for penetration with manual assistance, so basically a marshmallow in a coin slot type situation, and 10 was a rigid erection. In addition, the technician then noted the angle of the erection from the horizontal plane and obtained photographic record. Yes. And on one of the mornings after, they then did penile vascular assessments with Doppler ultrasound. So that's one hell of a morning after conversation. So the data was fascinating. We know that sleep-related erections happen during REM sleep. And what they found was that the men in the diabetic group had significant decreases in their duration of REM sleep and the percentage of time that they spent in REM. And subsequently, they also had highly significant decreases in the frequency of duration and the degree of nocturnal nighttime erections when compared to healthy controls. The study then went on to look at the degree of diabetes control and to see if the worse the control was, were the erections worse. And essentially, diabetic patients who were in poor control, which they defined as a hemoglobin A1C more than 8, or if they had retinopathy or neuropathy, they had significant decreases in both the frequency, duration, and degree of the sleep-related erections. And if you look at the data, some of the tumescence periods are literally half compared to someone who has controlled diabetes. So why does this happen? Well, it starts with obesity, specifically visceral obesity, because visceral obesity does a double whammy to the penis by leading to both inflammatory and hormonal changes. Hormonally, adipose tissue contains aromatase, and aromatase converts testosterone to estradiol. So being obese, you are in a high estrogen state, and there will be low testosterone thanks to aromatase. Obesity is also a pro-inflammatory state. So that results in the release of pro-inflammatory factors, which will then lead to direct vascular damage to the penile tissue. So combining the vascular endothelial damage with the testosterone deficiency, you won't have a functioning penis. So this was a very dramatic study. They took 800 white men presenting for the first time to a sexual dysfunction clinic in Italy. And these men could have complained of anything, you know, ED, premature ejaculation, decreased libido, blue balls, you name it. And they found that 30% of these men had metabolic syndrome, and almost all of them had erectile dysfunction. And what's fascinating about this study is that they then went ahead to do blood glucose parameters, cholesterol, hormone levels. And then these men had penile Doppler ultrasounds done at baseline, and then they were injected. Their penises were injected with prostaglandin E1 to induce an erection, and they had repeat ultrasounds done 20 minutes later to measure baseline velocity of blood flow and peak blood flow velocity. And this, my friends, is where the soft science gets hard. So what they found was there was a progressive decline in penile blood flow velocity, both at baseline and at peak blood flow, as the number of metabolic syndrome components increased. And this trend was significant even after adjustment for age. So essentially, those with metabolic syndrome had worse erectile dysfunction, essentially due to impairment in penile blood flow. And metabolic syndrome is also associated with hypogonadism. So they found that those that had 3 out of the 5 components of metabolic syndrome had more than a threefold increase in the prevalence of hypogonadism. And if they had 5 out of the 5 components, that prevalence went up to 10 times higher to have hypogonadism compared to those that did not. And out of the components of metabolic syndrome, the major determinants that were associated with hypogonadism were fasting glucose and elevated waist circumference. So again, insulin related. They also found that the circulating total testosterone levels decreased as the number of metabolic syndrome components increased. And again, we know that because adipose tissue contains aromatase, which then converts testosterone to estrogen. So this is great. You know, there's many studies on erectile dysfunction in men who are partnered, which is great. But the reality is most men only realize that they have issues with sexual function when they're interacting with another partner, or they discover that perhaps they're not performing as well as they'd like to be. So this is why I very much appreciated this next study, because this next study was looking at men who were not partnered, and they were simply relying on petting the one-eyed snake to get by. And This was a Chinese study that looked at whether weak masturbatory erection alone could be seen as a cardiovascular risk factor, meaning if you can't stroke it properly, are you at risk of getting an actual stroke? So these were young men, less than 40. They found a group of young men who were not sexually active, not partnered, and their primary complaint was only a weak masturbatory erection, meaning they would get erections, but they weren't as strong as they wanted them to be. And then they compared them to two groups of people, a group of men who were partnered, sexually active, had erectile dysfunction, then a group who were partnered, sexually active, but no erectile dysfunction, so essentially healthy. They went ahead to do Doppler ultrasounds on these gentlemen as well, checked inflammatory markers, checked glucose levels, and they were also subjected to a nocturnal penile tumescence and rigidity test, bless their hearts. So the erections, my friends, may have been weak, but the results were firm. There was no difference found between the erectile dysfunction group and the men who had weak masturbatory erections in terms of all risk factors. And when it came to the top four risk factors, this was endothelial dysfunction, insulin resistance, high level of glucose, and an abnormal nocturnal penile tumescence rigidity test. After they age adjusted, the model showed that it was endothelial dysfunction and an abnormal tumescence nocturnal test plus high glucose that were independently associated with erectile dysfunction and weak masturbatory erections. I think this is really important data because there's not going to be a lot of men that would come to a clinic with a primary complaint of having a weak masturbatory erection. But you have to treat them as someone who's having the same risk factors as someone with erectile dysfunction. This should be a reason to screen people earlier for cardiovascular disease. So right now, drugs like Cialis, Viagra, they're all getting prescribed a lot. But I think before providing anyone with a prescription for these medications, if a man is complaining of erectile dysfunction, they must absolutely be screened for diabetes and other secondary causes of insulin resistance before being prescribed vasodilatory medications. So the question is, does this problem happen similarly in women? And again, I mentioned the studies in women are lacking. They are not as rigorous as men. They're not as high quality. Majority of the studies in women and female sexual dysfunction, they're really just the use of questionnaires where women are subjectively reporting their experiences. Loads and loads of questionnaires. So many of these studies are small, short follow-up, significant confounders. I was able to find one interesting study also, ironically, at an Italian sexual dysfunction clinic, which is odd because they eat a lot of carbs in Italy, so I don't know if they're having a lot of sexual problems too. But this study, interestingly, it looked at impaired blood resistance flow to the clitoris. So they took 71 straight women who were complaining of sexual dysfunction. Their primary complaint was low sexual desire. And again, they went through this similar profile, measured blood samples, checked for insulin resistance. They went ahead to do Doppler ultrasounds to their clitoral structures to look for something called a clitoral pulsatility index. And what that basically is it reflects a resistance to blood flow. So the higher the clitoral pulsatility index, the more resistance to blood flow there is. And what they found was women with obesity or metabolic syndrome had significantly higher clitoral pulsatility indexes even after adjusting for confounders. And there was a stepwise increase in the pulsatility index as the number of metabolic syndrome components increased, even adjusting for age, smoking, and years since menopause. They also looked at the association between the increased pulsatility index and psychological factors, like someone's degree of body uneasiness. And essentially, an increased pulsatility index was associated with decreased sexual arousal and a higher degree of body uneasiness, especially in areas that were more closely related to sexuality, like the breasts and wombs and genitals. So Clitoral vascular resistance, or essentially impaired blood flow to the clitoris, is positively associated with metabolic syndrome and insulin resistance, and it leads to decreases in sexual arousal. It also leads to psychological issues like body image concerns. And what was interesting in this study, this was just something that was observed, it wasn't statistically significant, but they found that the clitoral cavernal tissues of women with diabetes actually had a higher collagen content compared to normal women. So essentially, this is evidence of smooth muscle degeneration at the level of the clitoris, which is rather terrifying. So just like in men, women should also be screened for endocrine disorders when complaining of sexual dysfunction. And insulin resistance should be one of those as well. And for women in particular, just a reminder, it's important to do a pelvic exam and to rule out other secondary causes like prolactinoma and thyroid disease. So before I pivot to infertility, I just want to take a pause. So earlier this year, there was this phenomenon in the media about something called keto crotch. I don't know if you guys remember this, but there were these anecdotes that people were saying they, after switching to a ketogenic diet, some people were endorsing a change in their vaginal odor. Now, any change in diet is going to change vaginal pH, and you know, no one's going to do the study where they're doing sniff tests while people are switching to a keto diet. I mean, there's no studies. I looked. So, but you know, if you think about it, one of the primary presenting symptoms of diabetes can be recurrent vulvovaginitis. And so, you know, I don't think keto crotch is a real phenomenon. I'd certainly prefer keto crotch to a candida crotch or something like that. So. Anyways, the internet had quite a bit of a field day on that. So, well, next, sorry, that's okay. So, after having sex, what can happen sometimes? You make a baby, or sometimes you don't. A lot of times, there's a focus on women as the reasons for infertility. But in 2010, 40 million couples were infertile, and 50% of that was because of men. When you think about insulin resistance, it's actually important to know that glucose metabolism is actually very important for healthy sperm formation and sperm motility and the ability of sperm to mature. In fact, if you look at the anatomy of a mature sperm, there's glucose transporters all throughout, and these allow glucose to passively transport through the lipid bilayer. And sperm have a mitochondrial sheath through which many oxidative processes take place. And followed by the mitochondrial sheath, there's the principal piece of the tail, which is basically involved with a lot of important glycolytic processes. So it's these glue transporters that allow sperm the flexibility to adapt to being in various environments, like a uterus or your socks. So there was a diabetic rat studies. They found rats who were hyperglycemic. They had impaired glutenine transporters, and these rat sperm suffered from low sperm motility and decreased fertilization rates. And when they corrected the hyperglycemia, the sperm motility rates improved, as well as the quality of the sperm. On the human side, I was able to find one prospective case control study. They looked at 160 infertile men, meaning they had an unexplained low sperm count, but they had normal hormonal profiles. And they compared them with 79 men who had proven fertility, like they had fathered children. And they measured hormonal parameters on them, insulin resistance, cholesterol, and whatnot. And what they found was that fasting insulin and insulin resistance was significantly higher in the study group compared to the control group. So, you know, it sets the idea that perhaps insulin resistance could be a possible cause to explain infertility in men who otherwise would have no other explanation. When it comes to women, there's actually a lot of causes of infertility. Women get a lot of attention, and the causes are far and wide. You know, you can have pituitary issues, you can have medication-related issues. From an insulin standpoint, polycystic ovarian syndrome is the most common cause of infertility in women. And just a reminder, polycystic ovarian syndrome, it's primarily characterized by dysfunctional ovaries, so absent or irregular menses, and the presence of high levels of androgen, and polycystic ovaries may or may not be present. It's polycystic ovarian syndrome is essentially insulin resistance at the level of the ovaries. And this essentially works with the presence of high levels of insulin, which then lead to the production of free androgens, which then further lead to the development of excess adipose tissue that then further causes a cyclic effect on the hormones that worsens inflammation and worsens insulin resistance. So in order to reverse the PCOS, you have to break the cycle. And in order to break the cycle, you have to reverse the insulin resistance by eating low carb. There are actually two small studies that looked at the effect of a well-formulated ketogenic diet on the effect of the hormonal profile in women with PCOS, and it was looking at their chance of conception. So the first study was a 24-week intervention. They took 11 women with PCOS, and they put them on a true ketogenic diet, less than 20 grams carbs per day. Only five of these women were actually able to complete the study. They had significant weight loss and improvements in their parameters. Two ended up successfully conceiving without the use of any medications. The second study looked at eight women with PCOS. They were put on a calorie-restricted ketogenic diet for 4 months. Four were able to actually follow the diet, and then two of them were able to conceive without any medical assistant. Now, these are small non-randomized studies, but if you take both of the studies together and you put the numbers together, so four out of these nine women ate a ketogenic diet for about a six-month period, and they all conceived naturally. So that's about a 40 to 50% success rate. You compare that to the success rates of medically induced ovulation, it's fairly comparable, and it's certainly more cost-effective. So before I conclude, I actually want to end with a brief history lesson, the history of Coca-Cola, because I think it's rather interesting, and it does pertain to sexuality. So Coca-Cola was invented in 1886. By a pharmacist named John Pemberton. He originally intended Coca-Cola to be for medicinal use, but he wasn't the most reliable businessman. He actually ended up dying from stomach cancer and addicted to morphine. And before he died, he sold Coca-Cola to a business tycoon named Asa Candler in 1892. And originally, Asa wanted to sell Coca-Cola. He believed in the product, but the business was not doing well at all. So he actually figured out a way to make Coca-Cola sell. He realized that if you use beautiful young women in Victorian dresses and you get them to hold the Coke in a phallic sort of way, the Coke will sell. And literally overnight, starting in the 1890s, Coca-Cola products began to sell a lot. And apparently, I mean, this woman is a total slut for the time. But what they realized was that this marketing strategy really worked. And as the decades continued, they continued to use this type of marketing to cater to this idea that if you drink this product, this is the type of sexuality that you can have. And, you know, they did quite well for themselves. I mean, Coca-Cola now sells 1.9 billion drinks a day. But I'm here to say that this is false advertising. I mean, party's over, folks. 40% of Americans are obese, 50% are insulin resistant, and I really have doubts about whether they are living the most sexually satisfying lives that they can live. So, in conclusion, I think sexual dysfunction in both genders, it could very well be one aspect of insulin resistance, and I do believe these patients should be screened for such, I think it's really important to understand that patients with metabolic syndrome are suffering from significant sexual distress, and it's our duties as physicians to address this. I think if there are men with unexplained fertility, keeping insulin resistance on the differential should be done. And I would love to see more high-quality studies in women. I would like to just thank the CrossFit folks for bringing me over. Thank you to Greg. I want to also thank two comedians that helped me write some of these jokes. If you like this talk, tell your friends. If you hated this talk, tell your family. And lastly, I just want to thank a couple of miscellaneous ex-boyfriends who I met along the way, because without meeting them, I would have never been able to sublimate my frustration into this educational talk. So thank you.